Today on the BV3D channel, we'll get a look at the new Cheetitech Plus 4, a fast 300 by 300 by almost 300 Core XY 3D printer. And we'll start right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. Hello, 3D printing friends, and welcome back. Okay, so today we're getting a first look at the Cheetitech Plus 4 3D printer. Thanks to Cheeti for sending this over so I could show it to you. We'll talk specs and features, see a few prints, and I'll go over what I like and don't like about it. So, here we go. Let's start from the outside and work our way in. The Plus 4 is a big silver box. The outer shell is plastic with a glass lid and a glass front door and a steel frame inside. The outer dimensions are 505 millimeters by 487 millimeters by 550 millimeters tall. The filament spool holder mounts on the back corner, and there's a nice 5-inch touchscreen mounted front and center. Moving to the inside, it's got a Core XY motion system up at the top, and it raises and lowers the bed with a pair of independent Z-axis motors. The build volume is 305 millimeters on X and Y and 280 millimeters on Z. It's got a direct drive extruder with hardened steel gears using an 8.9 to 1 gear ratio to push 1.75 millimeter filament down to a 0.4 millimeter bimetallic nozzle with a hardened tip, and that nozzle can get up to 370 degrees Celsius. The Plus 4's heated bed has a double-sided PEI magnetic flex plate, and the bed can get up to 120 degrees Celsius. The print chamber features an active heating system that can get it to 65 degrees Celsius and an activated carbon air filter to cut down on the odor of certain filaments like ABS. It's also got a camera mounted in there so you can take time-lapse videos or see a print job in progress. The Plus 4 can print with a whole list of filaments that would take too long to read off, so here they are on the screen. Speaking of filament, it also has filament tangle detection, so it can stop the print if the filament gets tangled on the spool. And it has a filament runout sensor, so it can let you know when you need to run out and get more. The sensor suite also includes a bed leveling sensor and presumably an accelerometer so the printer can do resonance compensation. Moving on to the firmware, it's running Clipper, and it uses the Fluid web interface so you can interact with the Plus 4 when it's on your network. And you can connect it to your network either via Wi-Fi or Ethernet. The printer comes with the usual tools Cheeti includes, so you get a set of Allen keys, a 7mm wrench, a standard blade screwdriver, a scraper, a glue stick, and a USB flash drive. For slicing 3D models to get them ready to print, the new Cheeti Studio Slicer based on Bamboo Studio is included on the flash drive. And if you've connected your Plus 4 to your network, you can send print jobs directly to it and monitor the progress from Cheeti Studio. Cheeti is apparently running a cloud service, so you can slice and print from your computer or mobile device anywhere, or you can run the printer in LAN-only mode and slice and print only on your local network. Or, if you don't want the printer network connected at all, you can save sliced files to the included flash drive, plug the flash drive into the printer, and select and print the file from the touchscreen. The user interface on that touchscreen is pretty intuitive, and Cheeti has a quick reference guide on their website that covers the basics of operation. Oh, I almost forgot. Like the Bamboo Lab printers, this one poops, and that's because Cheeti is expected to release a four-spool Cheeti box to enable multicolor or multi-material printing sometime in early 2025. I predicted they were heading in that direction when I reviewed the Cheeti Q1 Pro, which is the other Cheeti printer that poops. It'll be interesting to see how well it works when it's finally released. Okay, I think that about does it for specs and features. This video is sponsored by PCBWay. PCBWay is known for making low-cost, high-quality printed circuit boards, but they also do CNC machining, 3D printing, sheet metal fabrication, and even injection molding. They sent me a few samples, and I gotta say, these circuit board rulers and coasters are freaking amazing. And the clear resin prints of the PCBWay logo, these are 100% crystal clear. So whether you need PCBs, machining services, or even something printed in a specialty material your printer can't handle, PCBWay can do that for you. Check them out at PCBWay.com. My first print was this pre-sliced Benchy done in some orange Creality Hyper PLA. It printed in 21 minutes. It turned out pretty good, though the Z seams are somewhat prominent on the smokestack and on the stern. Some of the features that should be sharp are kind of smoothed out a bit, like the door and window frames on the wheelhouse. And there's a little bit of stringing inside the wheelhouse, but it's not terrible. So it's not a bad Benchy for 21 minutes. Next, I wanted to see how a Benchy I sliced myself with the Chidi Studio slicer would turn out. And this one took a little over twice as long, finishing in 46 minutes, again printed in the Creality Hyper PLA. It came out a little bit better than the pre-sliced one, though the corners still aren't as sharp as I'd like them to be. Apart from the Z seam down the center of the stern on this one, the rest of the Z seams aren't particularly visible, and there's still some stringing in the wheelhouse. Overall, though, it's good. After that, I sliced and printed a Calidragon from designer McGuybier. This printed in 37 minutes, and I printed it in some Polymaker PETG. It came out really nice. The surface finish is great, and there isn't any stringing between the antlers. I don't really see any issues with this one at all. Hey, forgive the interruption, but if you're enjoying this video, a subscribe would be great. That lets me know I'm making content you enjoy and you want to see more like it. Thanks! Now, here's Aria the Dragon by designer Luby3D. This one is also printed in that green Polymaker PETG, and it took 2 hours and 8 minutes. I don't really see any issues with this print. There's no stringing, and she turned out really nice. And I actually printed a few more examples of Aria in different filaments. Here's one in pink Bamboo Lab PLA. It printed in 1 hour and 43 minutes. It came out great. There are just a couple of light, wispy strings between the top tips of the wings. And that sort of thing you can just pull off. Other than that, it's perfectly printed and pretty in pink. Now, with the PLA and PETG, I needed to open the front door on the printer and remove the top glass so there would be enough airflow to keep the filament happy. But I also wanted to make use of the enclosure for printing ABS. So I loaded up some Novamaker red ABS that I had handy, put the lid on the printer, closed the door, and printed Aria again. In ABS, she only took 1 hour and 15 minutes to print. This came out pretty much perfect. There's no stringing, and she really looks great. Just for grins, I loaded up some IC3D yellow ABS and printed Aria again. This was the exact same G-code, but it took a couple extra minutes to print, finishing in 1 hour and 18 minutes. This came out perfect again, just like the red ABS one. No stringing, just a really nice yellow dragon. So that was an interesting study in dragons, and I found it interesting that slicing it for ABS gave such a good result and also printed significantly faster than PLA or PETG. While I still had the yellow ABS loaded, I printed this fidget cube, or infinity cube, by designer MJ Dargan. It finished in 1 hour and 13 minutes, and like the other two ABS prints, this one came out perfect. The surface finish is great, and all the hinges work like they should. Next, I wanted to push the printer a little harder and print something functional in a high temperature filament that needed to be in an enclosure. Since my current 4 rep rack filament shelves are full, and I've got filament stacked up on the floor underneath it, I decided I needed to add another level to it. So I printed a pair of wall cleats and hangers using some Bamboo Lab PAHTCF, a high temperature nylon filament with carbon fiber. I had to dry this filament really well to get a good finish. I think I put about 18 hours of drying into it. Like, straight out of the bag, it was pretty dang awful. Take a look at the finish on this cleat. But then I dried it for about 18 hours and tried again and got a much, much better result. Compare the before and after. That's quite a difference. And this, 3D printing friends, is why I appreciate filament dryers. Speaking of that, my dryer of choice was the modular Polymaker one. After that marathon drying session, I was able to keep the filament in the dry box part of it and just move that over to the printer to keep the filament dry while I ran these prints. The surface finish on these is gorgeous. The wall cleats took about 1.5 hours, and the hangers took about 3 hours each, so all told, this is about 9 hours worth of printing. I do still need to go to Lowe's to pick up some conduit, but I'll do that later. Then I'll mount these cleats on the wall, slot the hangers in, and add the conduit to complete the shelf. Shout out to RepCourt for making the RepRack files available for free. Such a great way to store filament. Okay, so that's it for the prints. So now it's time to go over what I like and don't like, starting with the things I like. I've found that the spool holder placement is pretty good, sitting above the left rear corner. It's not on the back, because that would be a pain. And the filament loads into the printer from just underneath the spool holder, loading in from the side, which, again, is not the back. Filament load and unload operations using the touchscreen are easy and have worked pretty well for me. Speaking of filament, thanks to the heated chamber, the Plus 4 does really well with ABS and nylon. And the interior of the Plus 4 is really well lit. The chamber camera doesn't produce the sharpest images, but the frame rate is pretty good and the resulting time-lapse videos are smooth. I like the overall design. Older Chidi printers have a different design aesthetic, often using two-tone plastic cases. But with the recent Q1 Pro and now the Plus 4, they're going monochrome. The Plus 4 has Wi-Fi, but it also has Ethernet, and that's, well, a plus. Some businesses can't have printers on Wi-Fi, so the Ethernet connectivity is important. And for those who don't want to put a 3D printer on their network at all, it's perfectly fine to save files from the slicer to a USB flash drive, put that flash drive in the printer's USB port, and select the file to print from the touchscreen. And last in the likes list, the Chidi Studio Slicer is based on the Bamboo Studio Slicer, so for me personally, it's got a very familiar look and feel. So now, here are the things I don't like. After all this time, Chidi's printers still don't include flush cutters. In other words, while the Plus 4 comes with clipper, it does not, sadly, come with clippers. Next, bed leveling has an initial manual adjustment step in which you adjust the four corners of the bed. Think of this as part of the initial out-of-the-box setup because it's really only something you need to do once. After that, bed leveling is fully automatic. And while the printer is capable of cleaning its own nozzle, it doesn't do that at the start of the manual bed adjustments. So if there's a bit of filament still on the bottom of the nozzle, it can affect how accurate your adjustments are. I think a quick firmware change to run the nozzle clean before the manual adjustments could be the solution. And last, sometimes, after a print job, the touchscreen is unresponsive and can take several touches before it responds. I have no idea why it's doing that. But that's it for the dislikes list. Okay, let's wrap this up. My impression of the Plus 4 is that it's a good all-around printer for everything from PLA and PETG to ABS and nylon and probably beyond. Although with PLA and PETG, you have to remember to open the printer's door and take off the lid. A minor inconvenience. But it prints ABS and carbon fiber nylon like an absolute champ. And the hardened nozzle is fantastic for fiber-filled filaments. The actively heated enclosure is great for those materials that need it. Plus, with carbon filter in the back of it, I couldn't really smell anything when I was running those ABS prints. I feel that with the current $799 price tag, given the build volume, heated chamber, and particularly its ability to print high-temperature materials, it's a pretty good deal. There's a link to the printer in the description if you want to check it out, and links to all the models I downloaded and printed for the video. So that's the Chidi Tech Plus 4. Thanks again to Chidi for sending this over so I could show it to you. Thank you for watching, and big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up and maybe subscribe so you don't miss new ones. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool, or maybe something hot, or something cool that's printed with something hot. That all sounded better in my head.